Hello students, today our topic for discussion is elements of the transport layer. So today we'll try to understand what are the different elements which comes under the transport layer. So let's go and discuss the elements of the transport layer. So one should understand basically the transport layer deals with two types of service or two types of protocol which are said to be nothing but connection oriented service and connection less. Whenever we talk about connection oriented, one should remember it deals with a protocol called as TCP, where TCP stands for Transmission Control Protocol. And whenever it deals with connection less service, it basically deals with UDP, which stands for User Datagram Protocol. Now, talking about the connection oriented service, what happens in case of connection oriented service? So one should understand, in connection-oriented service, a connection is first established between the sender and receiver. Then, the data is being transferred and at the end, the connection is being terminated or released. The connection-oriented service is generally reliable. The protocols which comes under connection-oriented service are nothing but TCP, which stands for Transmission Control Protocol, and SCTP, which stands for Steam Control Transmission Protocol. So here one should note down, in connection oriented protocol, what is important is that before sending any data, first the connection establishment is very essential. If the connection is not being established, the data won't be able to send to that transmission line. So in case of connection oriented, connection establishment is necessary, then the data transfer take place, and finally the connection is being terminated as per the application. And a very well-known protocol which comes under connection-oriented is nothing but TCP. One should also remember, in connection-oriented service or in TCP protocol, resource reservation is very important. So to establish the connection, first the sender has to make sure that all the resources which are necessary to establish the connection and for data transfers are ready. So first, the resources are being reserved and then the process takes place. Now we'll discuss what is basically connection-less service. In this service, the packets are sent from the sender to receiver without establishment of connection. In such service, the data are not numbered. The data or the packet may be lost, corrupted, delayed or disordered. Connection-less service is unreliable. Transport layer protocol that provides this service is UDP. So here if you try to understand, in case of connectionless, the connection establishment is not necessary. So without establishment any connection, the data is going to be sent. But the drawback is that since the connection is not being established, the resources are not being received, this kind of a service is unreliable. So if this service is unreliable, who may be using this kind of a service? Basically, this service provides you with the fast data transfer. So the application which needs fast data transfer and where the reliability is not so important, in that case, connection-less service said to be UDP protocol is being used. So this is the first element, which is nothing but the service which can be a connection-oriented service or it may be connection-less. When it is connection-oriented, one should remember it is TCP protocol, and when it is connectionless, one should remember it is UDP protocol. Now, talking about the next element of the transport protocol is nothing but addressing. We know very well, if there is improper addressing, the data won't be able to transfer successfully from the source to destination. We know also very well that each layer specifically has different kind of an addressing. So here if you talk about data link layer, we know very well the data link layer deals with physical or the MAC addressing. So in order to deliver data from one process to another, address is required. In order to deliver from one node to another, MAC address is required, which comes under the data link layer. Here one should note down that physical addressing is nothing but MAC addressing, which is of 48 bits and which is present in the NIC card of the device, where NIC card stands for Network Interface Card. In order to deliver data from one network to another, IP address is required. One should also remember, IP address is nothing but said to be logical addressing. So IP address or logical addressing is basically handled by the network layer. Now talking about the transport layer, which addressing it deals with? Basically, it deals with service point address, or we can also set it as port addressing. So one should remember, the port address is of the length 16 bit. So in basically, the next element was nothing but the addressing, and here the most important point to be remembered is nothing but port addressing, which is of 16 bit, where port address is also said to be service point address. So basically, data link layer deals with MAC or physical addressing, network layer deals with logical or IP addressing, and transport layer deals with port addressing or the service point address, which is the second element of the transport protocol. Now the next element of any transport protocol is nothing but the port numbers. So what do you mean by port number? We know very well the port address is nothing but a port number, where we know port numbers or port address is of 16 bit. Each communication process is assigned a specific port number. So in order to select among multiple processes running on the destination node, a port number is required. So from this diagram, you can make it out, since multiple app processes or the application is being running, each process has its own different port number associated with it. Yes or no? So here the range of port address or number ranges from 0 to 65535. Now, what are the different port numbers? Basically, the port numbers are categorized into three types, which are well-known port number, registered port numbers, and the dynamic port number. One should also remember, these port numbers are basically assigned by an authority called as IANA, where IANA stands for Internet Assigned Number Authority. Now, what do you mean by well-known port numbers? Basically, the port numbers which are ranging from 0 to 1023 are said to be well-known port number. For example, the port number which is 80, which is associated with HTTP, where HTTP stands for Hypertext Transfer Protocol. The port number 25, which is being associated with mail service, a very well-known service called as SMTP, Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. While port number 21, which is associated with File Transfer Protocol. So this is the first category, which is said to be well-known ports. The second category is nothing but the registered ports. The port numbers which are ranging from 1024 to 49151 are said to be registered ports. Basically, these ports are not controlled by AINA authority. And finally, the third category is nothing but dynamic port. The ports which are ranging from 49152 to 65535 are said to be dynamic ports, and these port numbers can be used by any processes or the application. The next element of the transport protocol is nothing but the socket address. The process to process delivery needs two identifiers. First is the IP address, and the next is port address or port number at each end to make a connection. The combination of IP address and a port number is said to be socket address. So one should remember, basically, combination of IP address and port number turns out to be socket address. Client socket address basically defines the client process uniquely, while the server socket address defines the server process uniquely. So here is an example that one should remember. What is the length of the socket address? Again, this length of the socket address is nothing but 48 bits. Now, how 48 bits? As it is a combination of IP address and the port number. Now, by looking at this IP address, one should note it down that this is denoted in dotted decimal fashion. That means it is of IPv4 version. And we know very well, IPv4 version length of an IP address is 32 bits, while port number length is 16 bits. So, this 32 bit plus 16 bit, which turns out to be 48 bit address, said to be socket address. So what is basically socket address? It is combination of IP address and port address, so which is essential for process-to-process delivery, which is handled well by the transport layer. Now, talking about the next element of the transport protocol is nothing but multiplexing and demultiplexing. A network connection can be shared by various applications running on a system. There may be several running processes that want to send the data and only one transport layer connection is available. Then the transport layer protocol may perform multiplexing. So multiplexing is nothing but running of multiple processes at the sender side is possible just because of multiplexing, which is many to one. The protocol accepts the message from different processes having their respective port numbers and headers to them. While the demultiplexing is basically the opposite of it. The transport layer at the receiver end performs the demultiplexing to separate the messages from different processes. After checking for errors, the headers of the messages are dropped and each message is handed over to the respective processes on their port number. So one should remember that the multiplexing process takes place at the transmitting side, while the demultiplexing process takes place at the receiving side. So till now we have discussed the different elements of the transport protocol, which if you remember, are nothing but the first service, which can be a connection oriented or a connectionless, right? The next element was nothing but the addressing, which deals with the port addressing. The next was socket address, then the multiplexing and demultiplexing. Now it is also said that transport layer service can be reliable or unreliable. So what do you mean by reliable and unreliable? So if you are using a protocol such as TCP, HTTP, which comes under connection oriented, then it is said to be reliable. And if you are using connectionless service such as UDP, it's said to be unreliable. So one should understand, if you need a reliable connection, we will be using connection oriented service. And if we need unreliable service, we will be using UDP or connectionless service. So if the application program needs reliability, you will be implementing TCP, will implement flow control and error control at the transport layer. But what is the drawback? It is providing the reliability, but the drawback over here is that it is slower and more complex. If the application program does not need reliability, it means most real-time application does not demand flow and error control, but it demands fast service. So wherein the flow control and error control is not mandatory, but fast service is essential, without reliability matters. So in that case, UDP is used. So basically, UDP protocol is used for live broadcasting, such as if you are watching live TV match in that way. And TCP is basically used for secure communication, wherein their reliability is necessary and no loss of data is basically handled. Now, here one more question arises, that if the data link layer is reliable and has flow and error control, do we need this at the transport layer? Because if you remember the functions of the OSI reference model, you know very well, data link layer handles error and flow control. While if you look at the transport layer functions also, it also deals with flow control and error control. So what is the difference between them? So one should remember, the error control and flow control, which is handled at the data link layer, is nothing but which is related to node, while the error control and flow control, which is handled at the transport layer, basically deals at the process to process. That's what it is being said over here. Reliability at the data link layer is between two nodes. In case of data link layer, we need reliability between two ends, because the network layer in the internet is unreliable. So we need to implement reliability at the transport layer. Why we need the reliability in the transport layer? Because it is dedicated for two ends. What do you mean by two ends? Basically, one process or one application which is running at the transmitting side, and the next end is nothing but the application which is running at the receiving side. So here we have discussed a topic called as elements of the transport protocol. So basically, so it deals with different types of things, which are nothing but connectionless service or connection oriented service, addressing, port address, socket address, and multiplexing and demultiplicity. Thank you.